ET is a 23-year-old woman presenting to the emergency room with a daily, persistent headache. Over the last month, she received antibiotics for suspected sinusitis, a sinus infection, but none of her symptoms were going away. Untreated infections here can swell and push into the brain, causing permanent damage, and the pain in her head had gotten more and more severe. ET had to temporarily leave her work at the bookstore in London to come back home to Paris to get this checked out. When doctors at this emergency room do a CT scan of her head, they see something on the left side. When they do a higher resolution look, they find something that they've never seen before, and ET wouldn't be going back to work in London. This wasn't the first time that something had happened on the left side of ET's face. Before she was born, the doctor doing the ultrasound thought that he saw her nasal saddle and nasal bone length were questionable. He ordered an amniocentesis, where fluid was collected from mom's uterine cavity using a needle so that it can be tested for fetal genetic studies, infections, blood type. The doctor realized after the fact. This caused everyone unnecessary panic. ET had nothing wrong. Everything turned out to be normal, at least this time around. When ET was 2 years old, her mother Cassie noticed one day that half of ET's face had all of a sudden turned pale white, the other half red. It happened out of nowhere, and ET didn't become unresponsive, she wasn't in pain. The color was just different for what seemed like no reason, and it went away within minutes, and she never stopped playing. Cassie didn't know what to think about this, but it was probably nothing. That's what their doctor told her, anyway. Throughout the years, Cassie would just notice little things. Sometimes, the 3-year-old ET was out with Cassie on a walk. They were holding hands. And suddenly, ET would just flop to the ground. Luckily, they were holding hands, so Cassie swooped her up before ET hit the ground, and they giggled about what had happened. There was no explanation for this. Originally, Cassie thought that ET tripped or just wasn't paying attention. But when she watched closer, she saw her daughter just go limp for a moment for no reason, and then pop back up. Like nothing had happened. Kids pick up the craziest microbes at daycare and spread them all around, and lymph nodes get swollen during these infections. Cassie would notice that ET's cervical lymph nodes, the ones in her neck, would be swollen for longer than all the other kids. But maybe none of this is out of the ordinary. That's what the doctor said, anyways. One day, when ET was 6 years old and playing at the park, she suddenly ran up to Cassie saying, "Mommy, mommy, my left eye is bigger and colder than my right." She described being dizzy and seeing double. Panicked, Cassie immediately brought ET to doctors. An emergency MRI and a battery of other tests were done to make sure that something like a brain tumor wasn't happening, but once again, everything looked normal on these scans. These episodes would randomly reoccur for the next year and a half, lasting anywhere from 30 seconds to up to 15 minutes, but they would always go away, and then ET would feel fine afterwards. And ET was examined by many different specialists, and they just couldn't find anything on the left side of her face and her head. And 2 years later, these episodes completely stopped, but clearly something is happening again on this side of her head now, bringing us back to the emergency room. Hey, I got a quick question. If you're learning something from this video and you're not subscribed yet, I'd appreciate it if you did subscribe and come back to see the video that I post next month too. I make on average one video a month since 2017, and I try my best to make each one worth your time. No AI, I do almost every single part of this myself because I do genuinely enjoy making these videos, and I hope you learn from and enjoy them too. Appreciate you. An MRI reveals that a large, atypical mass has grown out of ET's left ethmoid sinus and into parts of her skull base and is pushing into her meninges, the membranes surrounding the brain. Sinus infection creates mucus and swelling, but those aren't masses growing into bone, meaning that whatever this is, it isn't an infection. Doctors take a sample of this mass, a biopsy, so that they can look at it under a microscope and figure out what exactly is happening. As the days pass, waiting for the results to return, ET experiences an exponential increase in pain and pressure in her head. Her sense of smell starts to fade. A year earlier, when she was 22, ET experienced a familiar sensation. Her left eye had felt bigger and colder than her right. She had that dizziness and double vision that she had remembered from when she was 17 years earlier. But she didn't think anything of it. It quickly went away and there was nothing to worry about. All the doctors that her mother had taken her to over the years had said that. But ET clearly never forgotten what that felt like. She was an artist, and her artwork, for some reason, always focused on the left eye and left side of faces. At the hospital, ET's biopsy results return, but when doctors read it, they find that something is wrong. Our DNA gives instructions on how to make proteins, which is our physical form. Sometimes these instructions get changed, and we call those mutations. If the instructions change, the physical form can get broken, and the body can't function normally anymore. E.T.'s sinus biopsy reveals that the cells in the mass growing into the left side of E.T.'s skull are mostly normal, except one particular gene has been deleted in some of them. And when this gene goes missing, it causes cells to grow uncontrollably, creating a mass that the body can't handle. In E.T.'s case, this mass started in the soft tissue of her sinus and is now growing directly into the bones of her skull and the membranes around her brain. This means that E.T. has SMARCB1 deficient sinonasal carcinoma. Carcinoma meaning a cancerous abnormal growth, sinonasal being the area where the primary tumor started growing, and SMARCB1 being the one singular gene that was seen to be missing in the cells from that sample taken. E.T.'s cancer, known by its acronym as SDSC, was only first formally described in medical literature in 2014, and this is a problem. The cancer doctors at E.T.'s world-famous cancer hospital had never heard of it, or if they had, the case was lumped into a non-specific category called sinonasal undifferentiated carcinoma. But better technology finally allowed doctors to specify this particular sinus cancer. It's just that at the time that E.T. was diagnosed, it was so new that there was almost no information available anywhere. But what was known is that prognosis was poor. Not a single person who was recorded to have had it at this time lived for more than a few years after getting it, and there was no standard of care. But even worse, because the tumor was growing into her meninges, they can't do surgery because that means cutting into major nerves going into her brain.
Tumors in the sinus tend to spread and invade the eye and the brain very early on. And we really rely on chemotherapy to shrink those tumors and make surgery or radiation easier and higher chance of success.
If you'd like to see more of this conversation with Dr. Su and my friends from MD Anderson Cancer Center, check out my in-depth channel Heme Review, link in the description below. Her medical team proposes chemotherapy first to try to shrink the tumor, and if that works, then surgery could be an option. And they start. E.T. becomes extremely sensitive to light and needs to wear sunglasses even inside. 3 days of therapy pass and E.T. gets to go home. It feels like the chemo was working, but at home, she can't keep down any of her food. And 2 weeks later, when the medical team takes a scan, they find that the tumor on the left side of her head hasn't shrunk at all, but rather, it's grown. This isn't abnormal for SMARCB1-related cancers. The gene makes a protein that's part of a complex that allows cells to access specific DNA at any particular time. DNA is wrapped very tightly around histones, and this all gets arranged into chromosomes. We still don't know exactly why SMARCB1 loss creates such an aggressive cancer in the sinus cavity, but we know that SDSC grows extremely fast, just like it's doing in ET.
When you have a tumor that's growing so rapidly, you have a very small window for being able to operate on those patients. When you can't operate on them, you're relying on chemotherapy and radiation therapy. This tumor is not as responsive to chemotherapy as we would like it to be. So we're sometimes left with far fewer options.
Across the ocean in New York, E.T.'s parents were in touch with a cancer specialist. SMARCB1 can be deleted in any cell in the body, but all treatments for SMARCB1 deficient cancers at the time of her diagnosis were expert opinion with limited evidence. Surgery still wasn't an option for her because the tumor had only grown more into the bone of her skull and her meninges. As the days pass, the vision in E.T.'s left eye starts to become cloudy. But at this point, the cancer is moving so fast that in just a few more days, E.T. could no longer see at all out of her left eye. It was pushing down on her optic nerve. And as it continues to grow, the vision in her right eye would also start to diminish. The medical team in Paris, along with doctors in New York, propose whole brain radiation. They elect to send radiation to the general area. This breaks DNA strands inside the tumor cells, preventing them from replicating and spreading throughout the brain. This is at the expense of normal brain cells too, but they don't know if the growth and spread has become unmanageable now because the medical team thinks they see lung metastases. At home, after 3 weeks of radiation therapy, E.T. felt a tingling in her jaw and hand. She can no longer feel the lower part of her forehead. Exhausted from all her treatments, she can still speak clearly and slowly move around the apartment. She makes a point of joining her family at the dinner table every evening, even though she doesn't eat because she has no appetite. At the hospital, doctors were able to get an experimental treatment for ET, which had just been fast-tracked approved by the FDA for another cancer with the same SMARCB1 deficient mutation. But at the hospital, ET becomes so weak so quickly over 2 days that swallowing the experimental treatment pill is now a choking hazard. There's so much about ET's case that we just don't know. Before she was born, what was that happening on her nasal bone that was seen on the ultrasound? Because that's where the cancer would grow 23 years later. What were those episodes of sudden blindness and feeling cold on the left side of her face when ET was 6? And why did they reemerge a year before she was diagnosed? Because that's where the cancer would grow. All that time wasted with antibiotics when ET didn't have a sinus infection was unfortunate. In almost every other case of a 23-year-old woman having a headache and nasal congestion, a sinus infection would probably be the right diagnosis. It's just in ET's case, it wasn't. And when she did get the diagnosis, it was something that doctors had never seen because it had only been formally described 6 years earlier. And the genetic mutation that defines the cancer is called multiple different names in literature. And even the cancer itself has only recently been abbreviated SDSC. You can see that the preceding literature didn't have a standard name for SMARCB1 deficient sinonasal carcinoma. One thing that we do know is that ET did pay attention to and emphasize the left side of faces, and these are all the subtle signs and images given to us. There's been some developments in SDSC since ET's diagnosis, but mostly in describing it and categorizing it. We still don't know how to reliably treat it. All but a handful of hospitals around the world can accurately diagnose it. And given that the mutation itself tends to create an extremely aggressive, fast-growing cancer, it means that getting the diagnosis wrong in the first place is a major issue with SDSC. One of the biggest problems with this isn't even medical. It's not science. It's getting in front of the right person at the right time, because surgery can cure it, but it needs to be done early enough. Right now, we can only best help this by raising awareness. In ET's case, that time was possibly spent waiting to see if antibiotics would work for what was thought to be a sinus infection. 3.5 months after being diagnosed, ET no longer has the ability to move, speak, or even open her eyes. Her siblings and parents talk and read to her by her hospital bedside as she sleeps. At 6:30 a.m. on a sunny Friday morning, April 24th, 2020, ET's breathing started to slow down and something sacred and ineffable happened. For the last 2 days, her eyes had been closed and she lay motionless in her hospital bed.
But this morning, all of a sudden, Ella opened her eyes wide, so wide, and looked deeply into my eyes and threw them to something beyond. A few moments later, her dad and her sister and brothers came into the room. We were all together. We hugged her, we kissed her, we loved her, and we told her she should go when she was ready. Ella took her last breath only 3.5 months after being diagnosed with SDSC.
Hi, I'm Cassie Toulouse.
And I'm Jean-Baptiste Toulouse.
We're the parents of Ella Toulouse, the real patient ET. About 9 months before Ella started having mild headaches in the evening, she had a couple of incidents where she saw double. She didn't mention them to anybody and thought nothing of them. They reminded her of when she was very little, and she'd been told by all the doctors who had done so many tests that everything was fine. She only thought to mention these episodes once she'd been diagnosed.
We wonder whether that cancer hadn't been with her all along, since she was very, very little. Managed by her immune system somehow until it got overwhelmed when she was 23. And then 3 months later, it was over.
If you know something is wrong and your doctor keeps dismissing it, you need to keep pushing and get the exams that you need to rule out something more serious.
Nobody expects a young person to have cancer. If you have any symptom, if you feel like maybe this is something out of the ordinary, maybe this is not a sinus infection or antibiotics are not working, do insist to look for something else. It's important. Time is of the essence. We created SMARCB1 Hope, an association with two purposes after Ella died. The first purpose is to put researchers, oncology specialists, doctors in touch and help research to find therapies and new approaches to cure these cancers that are extremely difficult to fight. And the second purpose is to assist patients wherever they are in the world, to call on us, and we'll try to orient them so that they can get the best information, the best care, and maybe clinical trials for new treatments.
If you or someone you know has been diagnosed with a SMARCB1 deficient cancer, please get in touch. Please help us build this community around these cancers so we can help researchers and doctors find better treatments.
Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.